What, nothing? Good morning.
Good morning.
I'm glad you guys could make it. Oh, I'm good. Thank you. I'm glad you could make it. Okay. So, you did. That's right. Important question. What do I have here?
Toothpaste.
Who remembered to use it this morning?
What?
Wade, did you brush your teeth? Yeah? Okay. Well, you know, someday. So, all right. I have this toothpaste, and I wanted to do something with it to see if you could help me, okay? Can you help me? You don't have to brush your teeth. Okay, that'd be embarrassing. Okay. Wait. So, I want to pretend that the tube where... minty. Okay. I want to pretend that when, like, this is our mouth right here, and the toothpaste, those are our words, okay? So let's say that I say, Abigail, you're so pretty. Oh, and it came out, right? Okay. And then I would say, Wade, you're very handsome. And there goes my words, right? And then I said, Malachi, you smell funny.
Thank you.
Right? And it all comes out. Okay. Now, so I said two nice things, right?
What were my nice things?
I said three. I told him he smells bad, and that's nice. Okay. So, two nice things. And those words came out, and those are great. So we could keep those words out. That's awesome. But sometimes we say things that aren't so nice, don't we? Like, is it nice to tell somebody that they smell bad? Maybe if you're trying to help them. Like, did you put on your deodorant?
No.
Well, you weren't supposed to answer.
I did.
Okay. But have you ever had anybody say anything mean to you before?
Yes.
Don't tell me what it was.
Yes.
Okay. And sometimes people say mean things. And you know what? Sometimes I say mean things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Shh. don't agree so easily. Okay. And sometimes when I say mean things, I feel really bad after I say it. And so do you know what I try to do? I try to get my bad... Oh, those were the good words. Hold on. I try to get my bad words, and I try to put them back in my mouth. Okay. So, let's see. Okay. So,
Okay. Push the knife into it.
Oh, you try it. Okay. Don't touch the toothpaste, because it'll get all over you. Oh.
I know how to do it. You have a scalpel.
I don't have a scalpel. I feel like that's a bad idea. Okay, do you want to try? Go ahead, try getting it in there. He's got a dilemma. I'll hold your car. Okay, try it. Can't get it in. Close. Okay, good try. Malachi? You can't cut it open. You couldn't cut my mouth open.
Yes, I could.
I don't want you to. All right, here's the point. Can we get it back in there?
No.
It looks pretty gross, doesn't it?
Yeah, no.
So sometimes our words...
can't go back in there.
They can't. And you know what else they can't do? When I say mean things and I hurt somebody's feelings and then I say, oh, I'm so sorry. Did that make them go away?
No.
It didn't. Okay? So I want you to think this week, okay? About your words. Because somebody said one time, sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me. I think they were lying. Okay? Because yes, it's going to hurt if you throw a stick at me. It's going to hurt if you hit me with a rock. It will.
I've been hit with both those things.
I know. So don't do it. Okay? But if somebody calls me names, that hurts too. It hurts my feelings. So I want you to think this week. Okay? When you're thinking about something, and sometimes we get mad at people. Sometimes your brother makes really bad choices, right? Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes your sister, well, she might just be a little bit annoying, right? And Wade, you're just perfect, so it's okay. Okay? But those two over here, they have issues, right? And sometimes when we get mad, it's hard for us to think before the words come out of our mouths. I want you to think about the toothpaste. When you get upset, I want you to think... the words that are going
to
pop out of my mouth now.
I thought you were going to say eat the toothpaste.
No, don't eat the toothpaste. Are they going to hurt somebody? Or is it going to make them feel good? Because if they're going to hurt somebody, you can't take it away. Okay? Make sense? Yeah? Let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for giving us great examples in the Bible, and thank you for all the things that you do for us. Please help us this week to make good choices and to use our words kindly when we help other people. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Now there were some present at that time who told Jesus about the Galileans whose blood Pilate had mixed with their sacrifices. Jesus answered, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered this way? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish." Or those 18 who died when the tower in Siloam fell on them, do you think they were more guilty than all the others living in Jerusalem? I tell you, no. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Then he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, For 3 years now, I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil?" "Sir," the man replied, "leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down." I want to share a very personal story with you this morning, a story that not too many people have heard. When my mother was pregnant with her second child, she went into labor and delivered a boy. His name was Thomas Charles. Not long after delivery, she was told that something was wrong. Back then, they didn't have diagnostic ultrasounds during pregnancies to determine any abnormalities in children. So Tommy was struggling to stay alive, and he only lived for 2 short days. He had a congenital heart defect and was missing a chamber of his heart. The only way he could have survived was with a heart transplant. The very same day that my brother passed away, a newborn was found in a dumpster outside of the hospital. That little boy was healthy. When situations like this happen, when things like this happen, as they often do in our lives, we think, how could anyone do such a thing? The second place we go is, why would God let something like this happen? And today, what I want to do is take a deeper look at both of those questions. So please pray with me. Dear Lord, I just ask that the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts would be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. When my brother passed away, my parents struggled, as would be expected. They were both very strong, faithful followers of Christ, but they were really struggling. So of course, as a Christian, when you struggle, you go to church, right? No? No, apparently, no one here would go to church. Well, they chose to, okay? So they went to church and they found some support, but they also found some judgment. In the very first Sunday that my mother chose to go back to church after the death of my brother, she was approached by two church-going women, who went to her and said, "Honey, you need to look at yourself. You must have unrepentant sin in your heart. That's why you're being punished. That's why your son died." Needless to say, it took a while for my mother to go back to church. But isn't that what we think sometimes? Maybe, maybe not. That's what the scripture is talking about. The scripture that I read that maybe people aren't familiar with. And so when we look at this section of scripture, we see that Jesus is basically being asked, why do bad things happen? Sometime earlier, so you know the story and the backing of this, there were some Galileans who were in the temple and they were making animal sacrifices to God to atone for their sins. And while those Galileans were in worship, making their sacrifices, for some reason, Pilate's soldiers came in and slaughtered them. And that's why the people came up to Jesus and said, "Hey, Jesus, what do you think those Galileans did wrong to get killed so brutally murdered by Pilate?" They must have really ticked off God, you know, for him to let them get treated like that, don't you think? They believed that if you were killed, it was because, one, God caused it, or two, he let it happen because you had committed some sin that earned this punishment. And that's why Jesus goes on to mention another travesty that they were probably talking about, where a tower crashed to the ground and it killed 18 people. And Jesus looks at them and he says, "Do you seriously think that these people were guilty of more sin than everybody else? Do you think God condemned these people to death? Do you think he looked down here and said, 'Wow, that guy really messed up. I think I'll bring a tower down on his whole family.'" And the people are standing there thinking, well, I kind of did think that, but now I feel like you're being sarcastic with me. Maybe that's not what happened. Jesus says, "Do you think that's what happened? I tell you, no." And remember this, Jesus is of the clear opinion that God is not to be held responsible for all of the bad that takes place in this world. If something bad happens, you cannot automatically say, "How could God let this happen? Why would God do this to me?" It's true that sometimes God may cause pain in our lives, and he does that to bring us closer to his plan. Kind of like a dentist pulling a rotten tooth. But God is not responsible, especially for the evil things that take place in this world. But you might say to yourself, hold on there. He's God. He kind of like made the world, right? He's kind of responsible for it, isn't he? He kind of can do whatever he wants, can't he? Yeah. Let's stop to think about that for a minute, because it's a good question. But we have to look to the very beginning for an answer. I'm going to say that even though none of you guys want to go to church when you're upset, you might know the creation story, right? Most of us are familiar. Head nods. Awake. Cool. All right. Still awake. We're good. So God made the world in 6 days. And after he made everything, he looked it over and said, "Oh, man, I kind of messed up over there. I didn't do that one right. Oh, I should have taken more time when I did that. What was I thinking?" Is that what he said? No. What did he say? Yes. Genesis 1:31. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. So we started off with a good world. But have you looked outside lately? What happened? I don't think God would look down here anymore and describe it as very good. And it didn't take us long to mess it up. All it took was one bite of an apple. You see, God loved man so much that he created him in God's own image. And in his incredible love for us, he gave us free will. Free will means that we have the ability to make our own choices and decisions. Just like a loving parent, God teaches us right and wrong, but instead of forcibly ruling our lives, he gives us the privilege of making decisions for ourselves. But let's be honest, lots of times they're not the best decisions. And it started with Adam and Eve. They were given the choice to do the right thing and not eat the fruit from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. But they chose to eat the fruit, disregarding God's desire. And when they decided that they didn't have to listen to God's plan, they threw his perfect world right out the window. And from that day and every day since, we continued to daily make choices contrary to what God desired. As a result, God's perfect world isn't so perfect anymore. And who do we have to blame for it? God? No. Us. The world was great until we took over it, until we were responsible for caring for it. But the point is that when God gave us the ability to make decisions, sometimes our decisions aren't the best for everybody involved. So I'm going to give you an example. My oldest brother, some of you know him, his name was Frank. He was a pastor in Versailles for a little while. When he was in junior high, he was chosen to be Charlie Brown in the school play. Okay? So, as Charlie Brown, you look like Charlie Brown. And Charlie Brown wears a yellow shirt with a little black squiggly line, little shorty shorts, little black shorty shorts. If you know Frank, just picturing the shorty shorts is really enough, okay? Big yellow socks, big brown shoes. Well, the way that the junior high did it is that they would perform the play for the school during the day and then come back at night and perform it for the parents. So, when they were performing for the school, there were some kids who thought it would be funny if they stole his real clothes. Which is really kind of funny, no? Nobody? So what Frank had to do was go the rest of the day in school as Charlie Brown. I'm sure that he was received very kindly in all of his classes, right? Now, just to make it a little better, they didn't give his clothes back at the end of the day. And we lived in inner city Philadelphia, the city of brotherly love, right? Well, if you've ever been there, not so much, okay? So my parents both worked, so my brother had to walk home 10 blocks. 10 blocks in Philadelphia with the bright yellow shirt, squiggly line, shorty shorts, and some big old brown shoes, okay? He was received graciously. There were old women laughing at him on their porches. There were people rolling down their windows, yelling kindness at him as they drove down the street. So it was a real learning experience, right? Let's just say it wasn't Frank's best trip home. But God didn't force anyone to take Frank's clothes. The thieves did it of their own free will. And you might say, well, why didn't God step in and stop them from doing this? And the answer is because God only has two options: to let people make the good decisions with the bad ones, or to not let them make any decisions at all. You see, the only way for God to prevent all of those bad things from taking place in our lives is to take away all of our decisions. He just can't take away some of the bad ones. It's all or nothing. And to take away all of our decision-making ability is to turn us into mindless robots. He would just sit up there and enter our commands into his computer, and we would have no choice whatsoever of why or how we follow it. We would be people that simply did the stuff that God wants them to do, not because he asked them to, but because you really don't have a choice. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be a robot. This means, however, that some of our choices, well, they're going to be bad ones. We choose to go to war, and people die. That's not God's fault. People choose to eat McDonald's, and they have a heart attack. That's not God's fault. We choose to drive fast, and people wreck their cars. That's not God's fault. And you might say, okay, I can accept the small stuff. That we can't, you know, we can't blame that on God. But what about the other stuff? What about cancer? Why does God let people get cancer? Why would God let little kids get cancer? And it's a good question, but the answer doesn't change. First of all, do you think that cancer existed in the beginning of God's perfect world? Do you? No. Do you think he looked down on cancer and said that it was very good? No. So what happened? Well, we happened. We've introduced nuclear waste and toxic chemicals, pesticides. We've messed with normal foods. 60% of all foods in America are genetically altered. We spliced fish genes into tomatoes so they don't freeze. We genetically engineer cows to be bigger and have less fat. We even alter watermelons so that we don't have to deal with the seeds. We fill our bodies with so many preservatives that it takes longer for the human body to break down after death. Some of the identified causes of cancer, they include alcohol, smoking, pesticides, household chemicals, a high-fat diet, not enough exercise, cell phones, microwaves, car fumes, deodorant. And it goes on and on and on. One study recently just found that the chromium that the FDA allowed to be in public drinking water has been causing cancer. We are the reason that we're sick, not God. And why do I tell you this? To make you all feel guilty about being sick? Now we're all going to go home and throw away all of our tomatoes because they've got fish genes in them or something. I'm going to stop using deodorant because apparently that's going to do it. No, absolutely not. I would never blame my mom for my brother's death. I would never blame my brother or my sister-in-law for my niece's bouts with cancer. I would never blame my other sister-in-law for the cancer she's dealing with right now. But at the same time, blaming God is just as meaningless. But we all do it anyway, because it makes us feel better to be able to point the finger at somebody. But the problem is that when we blame somebody else for the bad in our lives, it makes it virtually impossible to turn to them for help in our time of need. It's okay to be angry. It's okay to ask why. But it just doesn't make sense to blame God for the problems that man has caused. If you want to be mad at God, be mad at him for trusting us enough to make our own decisions. And realizing that God isn't to blame is only the first part. Because God isn't just standing up there shaking his head in disappointment and refusing to help us. God's up there in agony over the pain of what we're going through. He would love to change this world and all of the death and sickness with a snap of his finger. But he loves us too much to take away our free will and turn us into robots. So he watches and waits for us to call out to him. And when we turn to him, just like that prodigal son, he runs to us, he rushes to us, and he offers his love. And he does his best to make good out of the situations that we've gotten ourselves into. So why would God let this happen? The answer is because he loves you too much to stop them from happening. So let us turn to him in our time of pain instead of away from him, so that we can find the peace and the comfort that we so desperately need when the world seems to be against us and we just can't understand things. Turn to God instead of turning against him. I'm going to lead us in prayer now. I really just want you to take the words and to allow them to help your thinking. Maybe to alter the immediate responses that we have, because so many times when things happen, it's easiest to get mad at God. And I'm just as guilty as the next person. We've got to start thinking. And start thinking of God as the loving Savior who's there to comfort and help us, not the condemning one who's just pointing a finger at us. So with that in mind, I would like you to continue to pray for my sister-in-law, Bernetta. She's gone through she just finished her third round of chemo, and praise God, miracles are happening and her chemo markers are decreasing. I want you to remember, like when I say that, I expect like a, wow, hallelujah, amen, sister, but we're not that, that's okay. Not 2 months ago, she sat in a doctor's office and they told her that she was dying and there was nothing else that they would do for her and there was no point in treatment. So when you come from that to this is healing you, we need to get more excited, okay? So keep praying for her though, because it is her third round and she will have 3 more. So she's only at the halfway mark. Are there any other requests? Anyone else? If you could keep my oldest, Elizabeth, in your prayers, she has more testing. And as always, be praying for Pastor Greg. Just continue to always, always, always pray for your pastor. Always pray for his family. Always pray for just him. So we need to lift him up today. Okay, let's go to prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for just the love that you have given us. God, I thank you for giving us this place where we can worship freely, Lord. God, I pray that you would be with each and every person that's here today. Lord, you know their situations. You know what they struggle with, God, and I just pray that your words would continue to offer them peace, hope, love, comfort, and joy, Lord. I ask that you would allow us to continually look to you for those things and not only turn to you in anger. God, there are so many things that were brought up this morning. Lord, we ask that you would continue to be with Bernetta. Lord, continue to heal her body. Continue to take that cancer away from her. God, we also pray that you would be with Cindy as she's just beginning those treatments. Lord, give her strength. Surround her with people who will lift her up and fill her with your hope and your peace, God. I pray that you would perform a miracle, Lord, and just take that cancer from her body. God, we ask that you would be with Hope, that you would also give her peace, that you would be with those doctors as they perform that surgery, Lord. Allow her to just be able to feel your presence with her. Lord, we ask that you would be with David Wheeler as he continues to heal from a stroke, God. Be with the doctors and be with his family. Lord, we ask that you would be with that 16-year-old who lost his life, Lord. God, be with that family. Allow them to feel your peace. Lord, just be with the circumstances. Just surround them with your love. God, we give a praise for all of those who are here this morning, God, just for bringing them here safely. I ask that you would continue to be with my daughter as they do testing, allow them to figure out what is going on. And God, lastly, we lift up Pastor Greg and his wife and his family. Lord, we pray that you would continue to be with him so that he might continue to do your work. Continue to stay in your will, Lord, and work for you. We pray that this church might be able to be a source of hope and peace and love for him and his family. Lord, we ask all of these things as we join together and say the prayer that your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.